Humanoid aliens, how plausible are they really? 6 years ago, I started my Alien Biosphere Evolution series, kicking off with the question of how likely it is for humanoid sapiens to evolve on other worlds. I concluded that we cannot really answer the question without taking a closer look at how evolution works on Earth, and how it then can be expected to work in similar biospheres. That quest is still ongoing. But in the meantime, let's revisit this basic question. Given the odds of finding something very similar to our own species somewhere else in the universe, how have various science fiction universes attempted to deal with the issue? And how much is there to be said for it from a scientific point of view? Well, let's try to find out, shall we? So why are aliens strongly resembling humans, if not being almost identical, so prevalent in science fiction? In the initial video of my Alien Biosphere Evolution series, I give three basic reasons. First of all, tradition. In A Princess of Mars, author Edgar Rice Burroughs creates an important precedent in fiction for a rather old idea that, on other worlds, we would expect to find civilizations on par with the ones we have on Earth. Second of all, given limits to budgets and technology, it's a lot more handy to just give actors some makeup and prosthetics, especially in the early days before CGI. But most importantly of all, of course, it's a question of relatability. We need characters that are human-like to empathize with in order to be invested in the story. That is also why science fiction invariably features humans as main protagonists. No explanation is ever given or even presumed needed. Intelligent beings from outer space just basically look like humans, and that's simply the way it is. This line of thought is especially rife in Star Trek with their countless alien races, each with their own tweaks of the basic humanoid looks. Apparently, alien biospheres are conceived of to go through some weird Lamarckian evolution, arriving somehow at very much the same results as on Earth. Strongly humanoid sapiens developing their own societies and technology along parallel lines. But they kind of double down on that though, because not only their overall looks, but even their genetics and reproductive systems end up being similar enough to allow for interbreeding between the so-called races. And that really stretches the suspension of disbelief for anyone with enough knowledge of biology. I already dealt with the odds of independently evolving a genome that is almost identical as to allow for this level of compatibility. And those odds are many times more than astronomical and practically infinite. So this is simply not going to happen even once, let alone as often as in Star Trek, and on top of that, during the same slice of time during the history of the galaxy. In one episode of the Next Generation series, an attempt was at least made to account for this. It was revealed that there once was a race of progenitors who primed the early evolution of disparate worlds with their DNA to make sure these all arrived at the results we see in the series. There is a somewhat similar explanation in the Alien franchise. A humanoid race called the Engineers caused humans to evolve on Earth as well as other places in the universe. Apart from that, the alien xenomorph is supposed to somehow be able to usurp some of their host's DNA, which would explain its sharing similarities with humans, amongst others. Still, none of these explanations are very satisfying, scientifically speaking, and more akin to magic. In Star Trek, it's unlikely for any such proposed genetic system not to be eventually cannibalized over billions of years of evolution. And even if it did survive, the Star Trek scientists would have found out about it already long ago by doing comparative astrogenetics, so there would be no reason for some big reveal. As for the Alien franchise, the idea of the Engineers also doesn't fit with the fact that we can trace the genealogy, so to speak, of the human lineage back millions of years and clearly see that it's embedded in our Earth's specific natural history without any signs of intervention. Also, again, It's akin to magic, to sprinkle some mysterious goo in the water and it all comes together somehow. And the idea of an alien creature like the xenomorph adopting humanoid DNA makes no sense either. It could only work if the xenomorph genome was very close to their hosts to begin with. Like I already pointed out in the previous video, not only will alien genomes likely use a different translation table of nucleotide codons to proteins and enzymes, the gene regulatory network would also be entirely different. An alien genome would speak an entirely different language, so to speak, and any outside genes introduced would be completely unintelligible to it. So transferring any genes from an entirely independently evolved lineage of creatures would not give any useful results. Horizontal gene transfer does occur between separate lineages on Earth, but these share a huge chunk of their genome already, as well as the basic mechanics of their genetic system. Now, I know that in later movies it was revealed that the android David ended up using the mutagenic goo to develop xenomorphs meant to target humans specifically. But the need for that level of retconning actually proves my point. And also, it still doesn't fix all the issues. So it's clear that humanoid aliens are simply forced down into their respective science fiction universes, whether that makes sense scientifically or not. In the Star Wars franchise, no attempt is even made to account for what clearly are contemporaneous humans in what is said to be long ago in a galaxy far, far away. In that sense, it's very much like a work of fantasy rather than science fiction. And just like in Lord of the Rings universe, we will find humans alongside other species or races that, incidentally, have overlapping phenotypes. And in a more recent development to increase inclusivity and promote diversity, fantasy and science fiction casting is changed to better reflect modern Western societies. This, by the way, is something I'm completely fine with. I mean, we have suspended our disbelief greatly for these made-up worlds anyway, so we might just as well go all the way. But what about those concepts, alien sapiens, that are only roughly similar to humans? Are they perhaps more plausible? Might there at least be something to the overall humanoid shape and body plan? Is the humanoid body plan perhaps the only sensible way to have a technological species? Here it is useful to distinguish between convergent and parallel evolution. The more similar your starting points, the more likely it is you end up with similar results. A good example of this is carcinization, which has become a bit overrated because decapod crustaceans were already well on their way to becoming crabs. So that's cheating, really. If we want to ponder on the likelihood of the evolution of a humanoid, we first have to ponder the likelihood for a basic mammalian body plan to evolve. And for a basic mammaloid, we need to ponder the likelihood of a basic tetrapod body plan. And for the latter, the likelihood of a basic vertebrate body plan. And for that, the likelihood of a basic bilateral body plan. The last one at least seems very likely, and that has to do with the polarity of life. Bilateral symmetry is very effective for enabling an active creature to navigate its world. It would also lead to cephalization, meaning the development of a head in the front with eyes. And on any Earth-like planet, this is expected to eventually evolve under the right circumstances and then rise to dominance, like it did on Earth. With regards to an internal skeleton and an articulated backbone stiffening the length of the body, that specific combination, on the Earth at least, is unique to vertebrates. Would that also likely evolve again elsewhere? And whenever it does, how often would we see the configuration with four limbs occur, as is required for a bipedal stance with three arms? We could actually do a thought experiment akin the Drake equation and line up all the steps that are required for this end result. We can then look at each step one at a time and see if we can make some qualified guesses leading up to an informed estimate. Hopefully we can eventually come up with a number like, out of all habitable Earth analogues, there will be 20% that would evolve humanoid sapiens, or something along those lines. I'll be expanding on this Drake equation for complex life in another video. And I'm also still working on my vertebrate recipe video that I hope to bring out very soon. That should hopefully make it a bit clearer what is required to evolve a basic vertebrate alone. In the meantime, feel free to share your thoughts in the comment section below and I will look at it. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and maybe even a sub if you haven't already. Thanks for sticking around, and in the meantime, till next time, stay sharp and stay evolved.